Live, right? It's a live test.
Good, so we're just testing volume, testing. Can you hear us? Testing, anybody? Testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing volume, testing audio, 1, 2, 3. It should be coming through on that computer, is that correct? Should we be able to hear it? Testing, testing. Let's see if it's...
Wait, hold on.
Testing. It seems to be working here. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Can anyone hear us? Ah, great. 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 So we're about to get started, folks. Just bear with us for one more minute, and we'll let some people join in, and we'll get started. Okay. Hi, Facebook. Just checking in to see if everybody can see us and hear us. If you can, if you're with us, thank you for joining us. Please just type in that everything looks good, everything you can see us, you can hear us. Great. So we're going to get started. Thank you for joining us, Doctors Without Borders. We're doing a recruitment information session for midwives today. I've got a MSF midwife with me, Kira. My name's Doug. We're going to do some introductions for ourselves in just a bit. I just want to let you know what we're doing. Recruitment information session, we're talking about recruitment for field workers, for being a midwife in the field with MSF. MSF is the French acronym, in case you don't know, stands for Médecins Sans Frontières, that we use to refer to the organization all the time. So Kira and I are going to talk a little bit. I'm going to talk about MSF. Kira's going to talk about what it's like, life in the field and working in the field as a midwife for MSF. And then we're going to take your questions. So feel free, everybody, to go ahead, start typing in your questions now. We're going to collect your questions. We'll save them for later. But what questions do you have about working for MSF, what it's like to work in the field, what are the challenges of being a midwife in the field for MSF? We're going to go through as much as we can, and then we're going to take your questions. So let's get started, shall we? Let's see. Great. So myself, my name's Doug Mercer, as I said. I'm what's called the Field Human Resources Recruitment Coordinator for Doctors Without Borders, or MSF. As a recruitment coordinator, I coordinate a lot. I do recruitment of applications, but I also do coordination of our recruitment activities, our recruitment events. We do a lot of outreach to different communities, different professions and profiles, like midwives, that we need to work for us, and I coordinate those activities. I've been with MSF since 2008, mostly working in the office in New York. I was lucky enough to do one mission to Haiti back in 2010 after the earthquake. But since then, I started a family. I have two small kids, and I'm kind of anxiously waiting for them to grow up so that I can get back to the field soon. Kira?
Hi, Doug. I want to know, did your kids have midwives?
They did not have midwives, but we had doulas.
Okay.
So, sort of.
That counts.
Yeah. It was New York, though. It's hard to find a good new life in New York.
Hello, everybody. So, I'm Kira. I'm a certified nurse midwife. Prior to MSF, I was a practicing midwife and director of a midwifery service within a private practice. I was also teaching students, taking midwifery and medical students. I was interested in MSF for over 20 years, but I didn't get around to actually applying in 2014, so it's never too late. I've done 3 missions, but have been to 5 projects, which shows the how flexible you have to be.
Yeah,
with
I didn't know that.
MSF. No. So I was in the Somali region in Ethiopia, and there I was in the Wader and Donot projects. I was in South Sudan at the Lankian and Mundri projects, and most recently in Bangladesh.
Fabulous. Great. So Kira's got a whole slideshow. She's going to show you a lot of pictures from those experiences. So once again, if you're just joining us, Facebook Live, recruitment Q&A for Doctors Without Borders, otherwise known as MSF. Start typing in your questions now. We're excited to talk about all things midwife and what it takes to be a midwife in the field with MSF. I've got 2 slides to show you real quick, just to give those of you that are new to MSF a little bit of background, who we are, what we do, so you have a little bit of the broader picture. So what is Doctors Without Borders? It's a little bit hard to define. It's kind of a this living, breathing movement, we call it sometimes. It's a large organization. We have 28 offices around the world nowadays, so it's an international organization. Technically, we have a definition that I like to use that kind of sums it up pretty well. We're an independent, international humanitarian aid organization, which provides emergency assistance to populations in distress, from armed conflict to epidemic response to malnutrition and natural disasters. So that's kind of the definition, but the key words are really independence. MSF functions almost entirely financially independent, but also independent of other agendas, independent of political agendas, independent of economic agendas, independent of religious powers. We're an international movement. We're not a French organization. We're not an American organization. We are truly an international organization. And we're a humanitarian aid organization. So mostly emergency response and not so much developmental work is what we do. We generally respond to armed conflict, epidemics, and a little bit natural disasters. I'm going to show you a slide of where we work. So this was in 2017. We were in 68 different countries around the world. This map is always changing, though, right? Because we're opening and closing projects all the time around the world. At any given time, I'd say we're between 60 and 70 countries. As you see here, 56% of the programs that we run are in Africa. So the majority of our programs are in sub-Saharan Africa. But that number's come down quite a bit in the last few years because of our increasing presence in the Middle East, particularly around the war in Syria, but also Asia, Europe now, on the Mediterranean, and other parts of the world. But you see, as I said, we respond to situations of armed conflict and internal instability. That's a big part of what we do. In fact, majority of our work is in conflict or post-conflict settings. 38% of our programs are what's called stable programs. But I think you have to be careful not to be terribly confused between stability and safety necessarily. You could be in a quote-unquote stable project and some sort of war could break out or internal instability could break out. So I like to say that potentially everything we do is an unstable environment. But the most important figure here on this slide is you see that we have 41,000 field positions, so staff in the field at any given time. 84% of them are locally hired staff. So this is, we call it our national staff. This is really the backbone of the organization, 84% of our staff. So doctors, nurses, midwives, OBGYNs, mental health, all profiles are locally hired. But as well as cooks and cleaners and drivers and chauffeurs. Kira's going to talk probably a little bit more about relationships and managing and training of national staff in the field. But I can tell you from my own experience, I think, we the international staff are usually there in a teaching or a training capacity, but you end up learning just as much from your national staff as they do from you. And at the end of the day, the end of 9 to 12 months, usually the international staff get to go home and the national staff continue to stay on to fight the health crisis or whatever is happening in their community. So like I said, it really is the backbone of the organization. So that gives you a little bit of an overview, a general sense. I think let's talk about midwifery, though. Kira's going to give you her experiences. Sorry. So let me pull up your slideshow. There we go.
Are you missing a slide?
I am. But that's okay.
That's your first slide.
All right.
Sorry.
It's okay. As it was already said, I'm a certified nurse midwife. And just like the majority of us, I've always been interested in helping underserved populations and people in need, especially in those low resource settings. And just as a reminder, I've done 3 missions: South Sudan, Ethiopia, Somali region, and Bangladesh. These signs here were posted all throughout the refugee camp in Bangladesh and served as a reminder to the countless humanitarian organizations that were there as to why we were there. In the Somali region of Ethiopia, MSF supported healthcare gaps in the Bureau of Health's Wader Hospital and other health facilities. We provided both inpatient and outpatient services, including primary and reproductive health, as well as treatment for malnutrition and TB.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. It happens. Let's see. My role in the Somali region was primarily managerial and administrative. I would, however, be called in to assist in complicated cases. Some of those cases weren't even related to women's health. Don't think that you'll just go in and catch babies. In fact, I personally didn't deliver a single live baby the 7 months that I was in the Somali region. My main focus was on outreach activities in 12 different outreach sites. And like Doug was saying, doing trainings for the national staff and helping them to be self-sufficient in their activities. It can be very frustrating because things are done differently than you were trained and what you've experienced, but they're usually done that way for a reason, and it's quite insightful to find out what that reason is. Here's one of our outreach sites. We provided a clinic under a tree, but the midwives were privileged enough to work out of the back of the Land Cruiser so we could offer our mamas a little privacy. During this mission, I was able to witness the construction of more sturdy structures at our outreach sites. Here is one of the buildings that was built, and you can see the area on the left underneath the tree is actually a school, and that is where we previously had held our clinic. My next mission was in South Sudan. Let me stop.
Sure.
We're missing some more slides.
Sure.
A large portion of them.
Sure. Hang on one sec, folks. Bear with us. We're going to just fix a technical glitch. We'll be right back. Okay, sorry about that, folks. We're just trying to get our slides in order. So, Kira's in South Sudan, though, right?
Okay. So this is a perfect example of just having to wing things. You always have to just kind of go with the flow with MSF. So not only was I not catching babies in the Somali region, I was working way outside the scope of midwifery. Here we're clearing camels off the landing strip so our supply flight could land.
Go ahead.
My next mission was in South Sudan. I was initially scheduled to work in the Lankian project, but the need arose in Mundri for an assessment of sexual and gender-based violence, also known as SGBV. So I spent an extra month in Mundri prior to arriving in Lankian. Besides constantly going outside of your comfort zone, here, this is just in reference to what we just happened, MSF requires a vast amount of flexibility. I'm a planner by nature, but I can wing it, just like we did. A teammate used to say the F in MSF stands for flexibility when asking someone to do something outside of what they would normally do. And I would quietly roll my eyes and think, but then we'd be doctors without flexibility. In Lankian, I managed the maternity ward, and here I caught babies nonstop. I did staff trainings, handled major SGBV cases, such as children and assaults that resulted in unwanted pregnancies. I was there during Kala-Azar season. Kala-Azar is a hemorrhagic disease spread by sandflies, and it wreaks havoc on pregnant women, resulting in miscarriages, fetal demises, significant postpartum hemorrhages, and even death. The photo on the left is our nursing station, and the other shows a standard patient ward. My most recent mission was in Bangladesh at the Rohingya refugee camp. This is what you've heard about in the news. It's the largest settlement of displaced people ever, and it's now surpassed 1 million occupants. It was an emergency mission, which proceeds at a much faster pace than your regular missions. As far as patients, we had women who presented late to care following complicated home labors and births, sick neonates, and complications following unskilled terminations. A large portion of the women that you came in contact with had faced severe trauma and assault prior to fleeing their homes in Myanmar. I have to say, out of all my missions, I feel as though I accomplished the most here. We brought sexual reproductive health services to two of our outpatient departments and managed a third. Then we opened a brand new hospital with a maternity ward in the middle of the camp. I could give a whole presentation on just that alone. This photo I took in the camp. So imagine, you're standing on a hill, and you're turning around 360 degrees, and all you can see is camp, as far as the eye goes, except that little mountain ridge on the right, that's Myanmar. That's
right.
Constant reminder there. This is what became the maternity ward at the hospital, and you can see they're putting the roof on. And this was the final product. Just to show a comparison of the diversity of working environments. Here's a slide of postpartum and delivery rooms in two different projects. Bangladesh is on the right and the Somali region's on the left. One of the biggest challenges you can face is not having access to equipment or drugs that you think you need or that you may need. Having to make do without a speculum or cord clamp or diagnostic test. You quickly hone your skills, and specifically your hands-on skills, and learn how to adapt and improvise. You spend a lot of time being MacGyver. Mm. Like using your body heat to warm a bag of blood in the OR. or making a Bakri balloon out of a condom. You also have to adjust to the cultural differences and that others' perceptions of you may not match your own identity. In some missions, I was considered white, while in other missions, I was considered black or Arabic or Spanish. You get my drift. In some missions, I was short, and in other missions, I was tall. Everyone in South Sudan would pat me on the head and tell me how tiny I was. I was even told that the only hope for my children was if I married a very, very tall man. Then I went to Bangladesh, where I was told I was a giant and compared to an elephant. I showed them the picture on the left, and they said, oh, they are the elephants, and we are just tiny ants. In Mundri, South Sudan, as far as living accommodations, I've been able to experience several different types of housing. In the Somali region, we lived in a concrete structure with separate rooms. The offices were in the same compound that we lived in, but all medical services were provided outside of the compound. In Mundri, South Sudan, we only had a team of four and lived in male-female tents with no privacy. Security here was high. I was one of the first women allowed back into the project after a security threat, and we had several more incidents while I was there. But not to worry. You're fully briefed before and during missions regarding security concerns. And there are no penalties or judgments for declining a project or leaving a project early for security concerns in your own comfort level. In Lanky in South Sudan, I had the cutest little tugel. Everything was in the same compound. The living quarters, the offices, the hospitals, etc. It was all very well divided and individual areas were respected. But there was no life outside the compound, and you're on call 24/7. This is one of our guest houses in Bangladesh. For contrast, our team size here was in the mid-30s, and there was no real security threats outside of normal travel risks. Just like housing, other accommodations also varied. I won't terrorize you with close-ups of these. You can imagine my quads after months of squatting. Mm-hmm. And as a precautionary note, each of these came with their own assortment of resident critters. My favorite were the geckos because they kept the mosquito population down. And I know that talking about food after latrines is a really poor transition, but bear with me. As far as food, I'd say the food in the Somali region was the most challenging for me. A standard in one project was oily canned tuna mixed with tomato paste. Now, I'm not a picky eater, but after 3 days of that for lunch and dinner, I needed to explore other options. Like on the upper left, where the outreach team was sharing lunch with me. But I have to say, food in missions was never a real problem for me, but I knew it was for others. And regardless, on cook's days off, we came together to make some really good meals. Sometimes we took turns cooking burgers, kebabs, and other meals from our native countries. Here, I'm helping Lucy, who is a Ugandan midwife, setting up the SGBV program in Bangladesh, prepare a chicken dinner. And on the right, we're getting the pizza oven prepped. In the field, we could always be counted on to find something to celebrate. Here, we're celebrating Halloween in South Sudan, and on the right are decorations and a cake from my farewell party in Bangladesh. Now, they threw it on International Midwives Day because, as they said, I was an international midwife, unlike them, because they were in their home country. We played volleyball, had karaoke dance parties, and went on outings. We don't get a lot of days off or downtime, but we try to make the most of the time we do get. It helps us keep our sanity. And sometimes we would just gather on the water tower to watch the sunset together. We even had pets and sometimes fresh eggs. So team life can make or break a mission. Every person that joins or leaves a mission changes the dynamic, sometimes for the better, sometimes for the worst, and sometimes just different. There are a lot of challenges in the field. You will get sick. Your coworkers and roommates and social network are all the same people. If you have a challenging day working with someone, you get no time away from them before the next workday starts. And then on top of sharing the same space with the same people 24/7, you throw in cultural differences and different cultures and belief systems. It can be a recipe for disaster or lead to a lot of humor and a much broader perspective. So why do I keep coming back? It's the relationships you build and some people that you meet that then become family. The two top photos, I'm in the center, and to my left is Happy. She was my translator and also my cultural advisor for a lot of things. And on my right, in one photo, is her sister, and in the other, her mother. Happy took care of me. She had me to her home for lunch one day. She invited me to a wedding. She'd call me at night to make sure I had stopped working and that I had taken dinner. Mm-hmm. And on my last day at the hospital, her mother traveled an hour and a half by tuk-tuk, which is it's kind of like a golf cart, for an hour and a half just so she could say goodbye to her daughter's big sister. The other photo is just is my maternity ward staff and the hospital. And they were just a great bunch of women. Here, I'm with the medical team from the Somali region. The center photo is a picture of us taken in the field. On the left is Jocelyn. She was a Dutch doctor, then me, and then Stella. She was our outreach nurse and from Kenya. And then farthest is Renika. She was a nurse from Holland and also our medical team leader. We've maintained relationships with each other for all the years since, and just this a couple of weeks ago, we actually had a reunion together. So it's those relationships, those friendships that evolve that, you know, not only for support in the field, but then they evolve to outside and regular life. And the final thing that brings me back is not only knowing that my life has been touched, but that I've made a difference in the lives of others. Nyatuk presented to the hospital with her 8th pregnancy. She had watched 6 of those babies die of prematurity. Now she was in preterm labor again, and this time with a transverse lie. She was scared. She was alone. She refused a C-section and left the hospital to see a traditional healer, only to return with an arm prolapse and imminent delivery. She did the impossible and delivered a 1.71 kg baby girl. It was touch and go, and the worst part for me was watching her relationship with her daughter and that desire to bond with her daughter, but also this fear of she could lose this baby too.
and wanting to shut offs to kind of help with the pain.
Was it C-section delivery?
No.
She did a vaginal.
Yeah. Wow. Which in all the textbooks will tell you it's not possible.
Yeah.
It worked for her because of how tiny the baby was, and all of her previous deliveries.
And the baby survived?
Baby survived. Mm-hmm. During their stay, Natuk and her daughter shared a small four-cot room with a mother with Kalazar who had delivered low birth weight preterm twins, and another mother who had had a complete abruption and delivered a preterm baby boy in Nepal. And side note, that little boy was the first live birth that I had done in 19 months. The three of these women banded together. They encouraged one another and cared for each other's babies. They supported one another when a baby's weight dropped and cheered when an NG tube was removed. They did all this while helping every mom and baby that came and went from that fourth bed. They did this for a month and a half. My favorite part of each day was going in and rounding on them in the morning. And they stayed together until they were all discharged on the same day, Natuk, with a 2.77 kg daughter. And this is what keeps bringing me back.
Fabulous. Great. Thank you, Kira. Let me just pull up the camera here. There we are.
Hi.
Thank you, Kira. That was amazing. That was wonderful. I apologize for some missing. We had some missing
That's
photos.
Right.
But let me just remind you folks, if you're just joining us, we're doing, this is Doctors Without Borders. We're doing a recruitment Facebook Live with Kira Smith, who is a experienced MSF midwife. So she just took us, in case you missed it, through some photos of her mission she's done in the Somali region of Ethiopia. She's worked in South Sudan. What was the project?
Lankian and Mundri.
Lankian and Mundri, South Sudan. And most recently at Cox's Bazar, the Rohingya refugee camp in Bangladesh. So thank you for that. Let's do this. Let's take a few questions for Kira. I still have a few recruitment points that I want to go through because I'm sure some of you have questions about like how to apply and stuff, and I can hit that later. But just while it's fresh, were there any questions from her presentation?
Yep. So first question will be, what actually set you on the path to leave everything behind and go on missions? It must have been different.
Who wrote that? Oh, you don't
it's
have
a
names.
Greek name. I'm sorry.
We can't
thank you. No, thank you for the question. That's awesome. What set you on the path to work for MSF?
Mm-hmm. And leave everything behind.
And leave everything behind?
Very difficult.
Yes.
I've always been interested in the service, however that may be. And MSF provided a way for me to put my career and my beliefs together. It was very difficult leaving a practice that I helped build and an amazing patient population that, you know, some women I delivered several of their babies. But just for the fulfillment that it offers. Mm-hmm.
And do you still work in the U.S., or is this kind of
a
full-time thing?
This is a full-time thing now.
Yeah. It's great. What else?
Great. So Sky is wondering, how do you prevent burnout and prioritize your mental health in the field?
Hi, Sky. Good question. Right. Burnout is a big issue with all profiles in the field. I'm sure Kira's seen it. Do you have ways that you manage your stress?
Yeah. I have a lot. And I will tell you, re-entry is one of the hardest things. I had an awful time reacclimating after my first mission. It was a really terrible experience coming back. But you do, you adapt. I meditate both inside on missions and outside. You always, this is why, you know, having team support is so important. because those are the people that are going to be there for you when you have an awful go at it. They're the ones to support you when you lose a patient, and they're the ones to, you know, celebrate you when you have a win, too.
Right. You talked about you had was it like your own personal translator interpreter team interpreter?
She was my own personal translator.
This is the woman on the right in the top two photos, right?
No, the woman on the left.
I'm sorry, on our left.
Yes.
And you said she was also a cultural liaison for you, right?
She provided that for me. Wasn't her official role, but she was part of the community, and she was Muslim, so she was able to give me a lot of cues and insight.
Yeah. Great. Go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, so next question will be from Victoria.
Hi, Victoria.
What type of communication did you have with family and friends?
Oh, yeah, good question.
In just about any project, you're going to have Wi-Fi. You're going to have some way. It may not be constant, maybe intermittent. You maybe even can FaceTime. Or, you know, sometimes it's an email that you can send. But you get pretty regular contact with loved ones back home. And people can even send packages sometimes. Those are always great to get in the field.
Did you get... How long were your missions?
They ranged from 3 months, 4 months, and 7 months.
First one was seven?
Mm-hmm.
And then 3 months was in Bangladesh?
Yes.
Because it was more of an emergency in nature.
Yeah.
Did you get vacation time on all of them?
You get an R&R for short missions. And emergency missions, they're more frequent. But after about 6 weeks, you get a day or two off just to rest up. Mm-hmm. And during longer missions, you get probably like 10 days during the mission where you get a complete vacation.
What did you do when you were in Ethiopia?
I spent half the time in Ethiopia, kind of basically just doing sightseeing. Yeah,
that's fun.
And then the other half of it, I met a friend, and we had a glorious beach time together.
Oh, good.
Yeah, it was really wonderful.
It was a beach in Africa?
Yeah, and in Tanzania. Yeah,
Zanzibar. Yeah, great, yeah. Yeah, so, I mean, there are a lot of ways to stay in touch, but some people use their vacation time even, I think, to go home or to see friends and family in Europe and things like that.
Yeah.
So it's pretty good, although 7, 8, 9 months can be a long time to be away from your support network. Let's do one more, yeah.
So you spoke a little bit earlier, Kira, about the need to be adaptable in the field. So I'm wondering if you could give us an example of a time that you took on a responsibility that maybe a little bit outside of your day-to-day job description.
Whoa.
How you handled that.
That's good. Let me preface while she thinks about an example. Adaptability, flexibility, you already heard Kira talk about it. These are like key, so I'm glad you picked up on that because everything changes in the field, right, every day. And you never know what to expect, and so it's important not to have any expectations at all. And I think The one thing that maybe stretches people a lot is working outside of their comfort zone and being able to adapt to do something that you wouldn't be expected to do probably in the U.S. So that's a good question. Do you have examples of that?
My first example is on my first mission. I arrived in the capital in Addis in Ethiopia, and we were stretched really thin, so I got a very brief briefing, and then I headed out to the site, and I was there and told they needed me at another site. And within a couple hours, I was put in a Land Cruiser and drove 2.5 hours out into the bush to another project, and it was just me and one other person. It was hard. I was like, what did I get myself into? It was much more isolated than I had initially
So you probably received paperwork and information on this project you were going to.
Yeah.
You had studied it. You knew the security protocols.
I was prepared, yeah.
And they shifted you to another project which had totally different context, right?
Yeah.
And they threw you right into work?
Yeah.
Like you had to just go right
mm-hmm.
to work. And how long, and you stayed there the whole time?
No, I was there for several weeks.
Oh, okay.
And then we actually, the rest of the team, we rotated in and out of the site and kind of put the two sites together.
So that's a great example. That's an extreme example, whereas
it,
you think you're going one place and you end up someplace else. You really have to adapt to that. Let me, do we have one more good one? No?
Yeah, so Elizabeth wants to know, what sort of training does MSF give midwives prior to
that? Oh, good. That's a good transition for me, because I was going to get into a little bit of the expectations for people who apply and stuff. So let me, I'm going to answer that question, Elizabeth, as I show you a couple other slides. This is just general requirements. So some of you may feel like you're thinking about applying to MSF. You're ready to apply to MSF. We can talk about midwives specifically in a little bit, but for everybody, we're looking for flexibility and availability. So we talked a lot about flexibility. What that means is somebody who can become accustomed to everything changing from one minute to the next in the field, and not having expectations about what to expect or what's coming next. Availability means 9 to 12 months. So Kira had a 7-month first mission, which was probably pretty extreme security context on the Somali border, or no?
I'd say it was a moderate.
Okay, moderate. And that's average. Usually your first mission, we don't put you into an extreme emergency. But we are looking for a 9 to 12 month commitment right now. It may end up being less, but you need to make yourself available for at least 9 months in order for us to consider your application. That's right off the bat. You also need to have 2 years of professional experience. So some of you may be midwifery training, in training. You need to wait until you've finished your training and then gain 2 years of professional experience. You know, how much did you have before you applied? Years?
My plan was the 2 years.
Yeah.
I was going to work for 2 years and head right out to MSF. And then 9 years passed.
You got sidetracked by your own business. Yeah, that happens. But she found us eventually anyway, so that's great. But 2 years, you know, the more the better, really 3 to 4, because especially for midwives, you're working very autonomously, right?
Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong. There's often you don't have an OBGYN with you.
No.
There can be gaps with there could be a MD family physician, but there may not be as well. There could be gaps. So you are the specialist. There are also, you never know what kind of complication is going to show up, and you're expected to handle it. So the more experience you've had in the U.S. or internationally dealing with complicated deliveries in perhaps low-resource settings. So I know there are places to kind of find these opportunities in the U.S. Some people work with Native American reservations or in rural populations or veteran hospitals, things like that. Even you can see some complicated deliveries, right, in big trauma hospitals and in the cities as well. Or, of course, working internationally. So we're always looking for people who have experience doing this type of work before within an NGO sector. Training-wise, and the reason we're looking for professional experience is we're not going to train you, at least not in midwifery or in tropical medicine prior to your departure. We're dependent upon we're looking for you to have advanced technical skills by the time you come to MSF. We do offer some induction courses, some software training on software MSF uses, and occasionally some French courses. And eventually, as you get further down the line developing a career, you might be proposed for a management training course or something like that to work on your skills to become maybe a project coordinator, to develop into a medical coordinator and manage entire projects or countries or missions. But as far as midwifery trainings, we're really looking for you to be ready to go. like Kira literally did, hit the ground running and start delivering babies. Let's see. I have a couple other points on that. I'm going to be quick, though. I think we already talked about this. Ability to work with an international team. It can be maybe the best part and also maybe the
most
challenging part of the mission sometimes.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people we hear, oh, you know, you think you're a people person, that's great, but you kind of have to imagine yourself living, working, breathing, sleeping, eating, bathing, well, not bathing together, but you know, with the, you said your team in South Sudan was four?
Four.
International staff?
Yes.
So you got to know each other really well.
Too well.
You shared a tent. And let's remember, it's 125 degrees outside.
Yeah.
It's incredible. The mortality rates are really high. It's incredibly stressful conditions. You maybe get one day a week off. So you pretty much want to kill your roommate, your bunkmate, and your manager by the time you're done with 6 months. So that's flexibility. That's adaptability. That's you have to ask yourself if you're the kind of person I think that can handle that. People also have different cultural backgrounds, people that different smoking habits, different drinking habits.
Yeah,
that's hard sometimes for Americans,
yes.
I think. So that's a big challenge. We're obviously looking for people who have worked, who have done a lot of travel, worked in developing countries, have this type of experience, communication skills. Managing, teaching, training is really important. You had a staff of midwives?
Yeah. In the Somali region, we had like 24 midwives in the hospital.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You were responsible for all of them? Wow.
And that, like I said, wasn't even my focus. I was doing outreach. So doing trainings with them.
Did you have to do like big seminars with all 24 of them at once? Or did you kind of have some one-on-one?
It was a lot more ad hoc. Like,
yeah.
We did organize some bigger trainings, but a lot of bedside teaching.
A lot of bedside.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So we're looking for this experience beforehand, right? That you've done some teaching, you've done some training, you've worked with a midwife staff, you've worked with younger midwives, and you know how to kind of develop them. And because sometimes you might be surprised. I think you said you didn't really catch a lot of babies in your first mission,
yeah.
Was it?
Yeah.
It's not that much direct patient care sometimes. It depends on the mission a lot, but it can be a lot more of working with the local staff, too.
Yeah.
Let's see. Managing computer skills, commitment to the principles. There are no age requirements, just so you know, as long as you have the professional experience. So we put people in the field in their mid to late 70s. We've
mm-hmm.
done very, very well.
Yeah.
We don't recruit couples. A lot of people ask that question. They want to go with their significant other or partner. Unfortunately, it's too hard to find an assignment for one person, let alone two together. You and your significant other might apply separately and both be accepted, but we can't guarantee you'd be placed on the same assignment. And, of course, with foreign languages, it's a major asset, and we're talking about French. You don't speak French, or you do?
I don't.
You don't speak French.
I don't. And it took me half the mission to be able to understand the French accent.
Oh, yeah. So, right. If you don't speak French, at least understand the French accent in English, right?
Mm-hmm.
But, so it's not a requirement. As you can see, Kira's done three missions, all English-speaking missions, Ethiopia, South Sudan, and Bangladesh. But over 55% of our vacancies at any given time are French-speaking vacancies. So I might encourage you to learn. If you want to continue a career with MSF, you're going to run out. You're going to keep going back to some of the same places maybe until you learn French, because it opens up a whole new world. And this is where French training can sometimes kick in. If you've committed to MSF, as Kira has, done three or four missions, we may be able to help you with a French training, put you on a French training program. And this opens up a lot more possibilities for you to work in a lot of countries we work in, Democratic Republic of Congo, Central African Republic, Chad, Cameroon, Mali, French-speaking countries like those, Guinea. Good. So I think that I just hit a couple of points because I know some people have questions about it. The process is to apply online, and then your application will go through a screening process, an interview process, and then we invite you to an induction course, a training in New York, and then you enter our pool. So you know you're not applying for a specific job vacancy, right? You wouldn't be applying to be like a midwife in South Sudan. You're applying to enter into a pool of field workers, and then based on your availability, based on your skills, we try to match you with the needs of the field. So there's a placement process whereby we find a mission for you and then propose it to you. So we would call you up and say, Kira, we've got something in Bangladesh, it's for 3 months, but you got to leave now. Are you ready? Pack a bag. Do you want it? And she says yes, and then she goes. That's the matching process. There are a lot of other components to it, but I want to stick to the midwifery conversation of this. In case you don't know, you are paid, you are compensated. It's not a lot, but it's a stipend. But you do get room and board in the field. You also get a per diem in the field,
yes.
Which usually is more than enough for whatever you want to buy, a Coke or a beer.
Yeah.
So your salary goes into your bank account back in New York, and you can, if you're on, you know, save up some money that way. You get health, dental, and vision while you're in the field, but as an American, you also get it a 3-month extension of your health insurance post-mission. So after you come back, you've got 3 months of coverage. You don't have to go right back to work, get a job.
Yeah.
You don't have to stress about it. You can relax. You can unwind. You can plan your next mission, figure out your next move, and you're fully covered during that time, which is really nice. You see some other benefits here. We talked about vacation time. You accrue. Basically, it comes about a week every 3 months. You get off. Consultations and psychosocial care support as well. Okay, so I wanted to run through that because it might answer a few questions. We've got 5-10 minutes left. I want to take a few more questions just to make sure, everybody's still engaged. If you're just joining us late, welcome, though. It's a recruitment information session, Doctors Without Borders. We're talking with Kira Smith, who's an experienced MSF midwife field worker. She's worked in Ethiopia, South Sudan, and Bangladesh. We're happy to answer your questions.
Yeah, so a question from Medina. What are some tips to be doing or learning meanwhile to help prepare before your 2 years of experience? I was thinking of doing an emergency medical training or working in the U.S.
Oh, good question. Gaining experience in the U.S., I assume?
In the U.S.
Any tips?
Hi, Medina. Head down to... the local Planned Parenthood, volunteer there on a few days for them that are high volume. ER is, you see a lot of things in the ER, and I think that's a really good way to get prepared, especially kind of the high pace. I think those are two really good things you can do. I can't think of anything else we're about right off the top of my head.
Those are good. A few midwives that we have practice at a place or train at a place called La Luz. You know this place? Mm-hmm. There's a training center in, I think it's in New Mexico, a lot of people speak highly of, because you're working with really limited resources. So, but I think that can happen anywhere, like you said, the local Planned Parenthood as well. Places where you really have to use your skills, right? You have to develop those skills, and you're not so reliant on other people. So I think working independently and getting as much autonomous experience as possible is a big key.
And in underserved areas.
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got one from Jocelyn. She'd like to know, in terms of availability, how long do you give sort of a heads up to prepare to go on mission? How do midwives prepare for leaving if they have clients back home?
Oh, good question. I'll answer the first part. So, we sort of jokingly say go, 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 because we're an emergency response organization, mm-hmm. and when they call you, sometimes it is. But we can generally plan some of these departures pretty far in advance, I would say.
Yeah.
2 to 3 weeks is what we like, the way we like to work. It's up to you. How much notice do you need? We want to respect the fact that you may have to give notice on your current job, or you may have a lease to get out of or something like that. So if you need 2 to 3 weeks to pack your bag, give notice on your job and be ready to go, that's generally fine. The more flexible you can be with your timing, because it may mean less days with a handover in the field. You may have time with your predecessor to do a handover in the field if you're willing to leave a little bit earlier. What did you do to sort of prepare yourself? I don't know if you remember your first mission. You had much time?
Yeah, I actually had too much time. there were some visa issues.
Oh,
so
right.
My departure was delayed, which meant I didn't get a handover in the field, which did make things a little bit harder, especially on your first mission. I gave up my condo. One thing you can do is if you have a job, that you want to keep for after your mission, always ask for a leave of absence. And that's the route that I was going with. And then, yeah, I just went with it and decided this was going to be it. But yeah, there's lots of things that you can prepare, get the essentials, that you'll need regardless of what mission you'll go on, earplugs, those types of things.
We try to help you with the packing list as well.
It's very helpful.
What to pack. Everybody different things. Everybody has different ideas about what to pack and what to bring. But leave of absence is a really good idea if you can get it from your current employer. Other questions?
Yeah, so this is one for Doug. Does MSF only accept certified nurse midwives? Do we also take certified professional midwives and licensed midwives?
We do. We accept CPM, CMs, licensed midwives, LMs, and CNMs, right? I think that covers all of them. Yes, the key is less about your license and more about your experience, right?
Yeah.
So we're looking more for experience doing complicated deliveries. Excuse me. In a clinical setting, preference to having worked in a hospital, so internationally or domestically in a hospital setting, but clinical experience could be a home birth or could be in a birthing center as well. It's more really about the experience with breaches, with breech deliveries, with hemorrhaging, with complicated deliveries. So you don't see a lot of that in the U.S., right?
No.
With those type of deliveries.
No, you don't.
So this is where the kind of getting prior international experience. Yeah. Had you done any international work prior to this?
I had more study abroad type thing than actual work, but yeah.
Yeah. So we always encourage people to try to do international work, find other NGOs, whatever you can. Most people that come to MSF do have significant experience doing this work already, and that's where you're going to get the complicated delivery experience as well to prepare you for the field.
And just to add to that, a lot of the midwives that you may be working with from other countries aren't nurses or have much different licensing
right.
than you do.
Right.
And so it really is based on experience.
Right.
And they're extremely experienced.
All right, so we've got one more question from Rubia. She's asking, 2 years of experience can be a very wide range from one CPM to another. Could there be especially with fewer births, is there a gauge for those of us working in smaller population areas? Limited experience.
So the question's about the type of experience rather than the length of experience?
Exactly.
I mean, it's flexible. I mean, two years is generally the minimum, but if you've got 20 months of experience that's really significant in a certain, and relevant in this type of work, like I said, doing complicated deliveries, it could be something we would consider. So myself and two other recruiters here at MSF-USA, we have our eyes on every single application. So we're really looking at the quality of your overall application. So the more details you can give us about your experience, it's something that we might consider. We do try to hold the standard really to 2 years for the reasons that I said, that you're working so independently in the field and that we know you can handle this work on your own. But the type of experience you have is certainly more important. All the time.
I think we have time for one more question.
Okay,
right?
Great.
So, Kira, Esther wants to know, if you go back and prepare for your first mission again, how would you prepare and would you do anything differently?
Hi, Esther. Oh, there's lots of things. What would I have done differently? I think I would have, I would have been a lot more prepared to kind of go with the flow. And I did go with the flow, but on the inside, it was nerve-wracking. but just kind of just going with it. I probably would not have taken as much as I did, packing wise.
Mm-hmm.
I can't think of.
Yeah. I mean, I mean, it, It's one thing, I think, to feel like you're flexible and you're going with the flow. Like you kind of get, you think, okay, I'm in the mindset, whatever happens. But the reality of the field hits you, and it moves very, very fast when you get there, right? And it's, you no matter what, you have an idea of what it's going to be like. You have a picture in your mind, and you think you're free of that. But then it shows up, and it, no matter what, it's never the picture that you had in your mind. And making that adjustment, and I think making the cultural adjustment, the living adjustment, the adjusting to your team and all of that, mm-hmm. I'm not sure it would have been something you could have prepared for differently, unless people have some sort of secret to letting go of all of those expectations in advance. But you really, really never know what to expect. And so I keep saying dropping those expectations, it's easier said than done. I think believing in yourself, being confident in your skills, in your clinical skills as well, because a lot of people think they're going to get there and they're not going to be able to do the work, but you're usually surprised that you handled it pretty well.
Yeah.
The challenges are probably more on a personal level, right?
Yeah.
So it's really just about, for me, maybe I would recommend talking to other people who've done this work, reading blogs, watching as many videos as you can to get a real sense of what the life is like Kira's photos, and you know, just how flexible and adaptable you need to be in order to adjust to it.
And
it's hard to prepare.
Yeah. Getting an idea, in the U.S., babies that are breech are usually suctioned, or you don't really see that many eclamptics because we catch it way before it happens. So being prepared for those things, of what happens if we didn't catch the things we do in our everyday practice, what's the end result? And then being able to know how to handle that end result. I no longer worry about a patient with a hemoglobin of 9 because I've had patients with a hemoglobin of 3 walk in to the clinic. So I think taking that knowledge a little bit further than what your normal practice is really helps to prepare too. And during this whole time, like Doug was saying, you're also adapting to everything being different. Everything. Mm-hmm. Sleeping under a mosquito net.
Eating rice and beans.
So
you take all that. So you're and being prepared for challenging outcomes,
yeah.
right? And
yeah.
That you wouldn't have had in the U.S.
Yes.
And that situation where if I were only in the U.S., this might have been a different outcome, right? Because I'd have different resources.
Yeah.
So being able to adapt to that. I think that's a really hard part of saying, are we making a difference here? How much am I helping? Because what you're seeing is very different from what you experienced. It's a good thing.
We do have one more great question for you, Kira.
Right.
Elizabeth wants to know how your relationships were with the national staff. How are you received by the midwives in country?
Hi, Elizabeth. It really varied in each of the projects. I really had to prove myself in the Somali region. The midwives there wanted very little to do with me. And it wasn't until we had a pretty major case that they saw me in action and they said, all right, we'll let her be part of the gang. And then my relationships with them, they trusted me more because they've seen expats that they come and go. So they have a new manager every 6 months. I mean, can you imagine your boss changing,
right.
you know, that often?
Right.
And the project's been there for, 20 years.
Right.
Once you have to welcome them and then they'll welcome you. In other projects, they were welcoming right away. I kind of have a philosophy of, depending on the length of your mission, this time frame will vary, but you know, you go in for a 9-month mission, and your first month, you do nothing. You observe, you kind of take notes, and just see how things are done. Because every expat that came before you and every expat that's going to come after you goes in there and changes things. And until you know why things are done a certain way and really understand in that context, then don't change anything. And what you may be implementing may be something that was just done 2 missions ago and didn't work then. So really finding out what your team needs from you, and kind of waiting and before you jump into changes.
That's a great answer. So I think that's a great place to stop, too. Thank you all for staying with us for your time. I want to encourage you to keep asking questions. So this Facebook Live will be up for a while, and we're going to try and answer every single one of you. So feel free to continue with your questions, or you can always email them to us, fhroutreach@newyork.msf.org. We're happy to answer as many as we can, actually. Doctors.borders.org/work-in-the-field is where you'll find a lot more information about different profiles we're recruiting, life in the field, benefits and compensation, career opportunities, and also, of course, also our actual application. If you're ready to apply online, you meet the minimum standards, please go ahead, fill out an application, submit it, give us a few weeks to get back to you, and we'll start that process as well. So again, doctorswithoutborders.org. I'm Doug and this is Kira. We want to thank you so much for joining us, and join the movement. Take the plunge. Become a field worker like Kira. It's worth it.
It really is.
Thank you very much, Facebook. Have a nice evening. Good night.